So, yeah, this is probably the last time we're going to be down here, but it's always a challenge in the night to try to show you what this storm is doing. So take a look at where I am, and now we can ask the steward to sort of pan the camera off into the parking lot here. And that's where you really get a sense of the volume of water and the amount of wind load that is blasting across the landscape here. And again, we are in a sheltered area, so we're not getting the full blast of this storm, but the eye wall's really close to us now. You can tell that. You can hear a lot of things banging around in the darkness, and we've had the power go off and on. They say it never goes out here. We'll see. Tonight is really going to be a test, but, you know, this storm is clearly roaring, and you're reaching that critical moment here. For anybody who is hunkered inside their home, you have a dual worry here. That's, of course, the wind, but it's the storm surge. It's the other one you've got to worry about, plus the tremendous volume of rain that's now falling down. You know, we have slight damage on the property here, but in the exposed areas, especially right down at the coast, they would be getting hammered by all of this. And it's going to continue for some time now. But you know, the blast just sting. It's hard to stay standing. And it's definitely a lot of wind and rain that is coming down. It's going to continue like this for the next hour to two here. In fact, I think I'm going to get out of it and send it back to the two of you.
I got to say, Martin, as you keep walking, we'll keep his shot up as we talk about this, Chris. We've both been in these situations, and you know right now, once it starts to make landfall, this is just the beginning. And something that you have never heard, I've never heard, and I'm sure Martin Savage and our meteorologists who we're going to get to have never heard, unsurvivable storm surges.
Yeah, I mean, look, they were trying to encourage evacuation. And look, you know, growing up there, you know, it's, you know, people when they're not in that lifestyle, they're like, why would you not leave? Mm-hmm. People are afraid they won't be able to get back. People don't have places to go. They don't have money. They can't
COVID
take their
this
pets.
Time.
And now you got COVID. People are afraid of it. And, you know, the vice president tonight said we're in a time of testing. Yeah, but we don't have the tests during this time of testing. We don't have the rapid tests so that people like your family down in Baton Rouge can have the confidence that they'd be able to get quick feedback about where they're going and if they're
going to go to a shelter. Who wants to go to a shelter when you may become exposed to a deadly virus?
So the idea that the pandemic is over, no, it's actually affecting people's choices in real time. But we got to say, you know, Martin Savage has preternatural calm in that situation. Mm-hmm. This shot from his photographer that they're working with, this is the perfect shot. Look at the wind through the light. And that is what is going to change the surrounding there, even in somewhat of a sheltered area. Don't let his calm belie a sense of calm in the situation. Mm-hmm. You know, it takes a real seasoned pro to be that calm in that kind of situation. And that shot really shows, even on the outer bounds of a storm, does not mean you're out of trouble, and often the duration is longer on the outer bands.
Hey, real quick, before we get to Tom Sater, I know that Martin is there because I hear him talking. Martin, can you still hear me?
Yeah, I'm here. Yeah, I can.
So,
I can.
Even in just the couple of minutes that we've had you on the air here, have you noticed the winds pick up in just that small amount of time?
Oh, yeah. No, it's I mean, with every gust that you get, you can tell that it's much more violent. You can actually sense it. I mean, you and you guys know all of this. You've been out here, but the you feel the pressure, which is the indication that a big blow is coming. So it's sort of a the whole body senses this storm, and then comes a huge blast, and then you see the trees bend and snap, and then the volume. You just to watch that water go by the lights. That's why we had to come up here. Most of the area around us is black. So it's clear you've been watching transformers blow and you've been watching sort of the electrical grid around us begin to dissolve, hopefully just temporarily. But it has stayed on here, and that's what gives you this tremendous view. Otherwise, you would be in the dark, and that's what's terrifying about these storms. If you can't see it and all you can do is hear it, your mind goes to its darkest and worst places. The visual isn't too far from that either. This is why you need to leave. Of course, you can't now. But it's a stunning thing to watch.
Hey, Martin, I want you to stand by. Chris, as we keep Martin and the shot up, what do you say we bring our meteorologist in?
Tom Sater. He's in the Weather Center. Give us the latest on what's happening. But also, Tom, give us a little nod, please, about the speed of this, 15 miles an hour, and what that means, and in terms of how broad this storm is, so that the outer band devastation as well.
Okay, no, those are great questions. We had official landfall 2 a.m. Eastern Time. It's 1 a.m. Central Daylight Time, right over the town of Cameron. Most likely, Cameron's elevation, we were figuring out, it's probably like 5 to 10 feet at the most. It's underwater. There is no doubt about it. When you see the eye center become so symmetrical and clear, it's a pure signature that it's a violent storm. This now joins an elite group. It's in the top 10, a small elite group of the most dangerous hurricanes to ever make landfall into the U.S. Top 10. Our records go back to 1851. That is staggering. We now have that landfall. Look on radar here. A couple of things to point out. Tornado watch is in effect until 8 in the morning. We had a few bands already moving into the area well in advance of the eye, knocking out power in camera. There will be more of that. And let's see if there's any warnings going on right now. If you're getting close, look at this. There's a tornado warning for that entire band. They're moving so fast, they're not going to put these for the individual cells. So again, that's a concern. Remember, East of Eus just 3 weeks ago, we had over 20 tornadoes, and it took a few lives. But when you're talking about the eye wall now, these eye walls are several miles wide. We estimate that with Laura here, it's probably about 10 to 15 miles. And if you look at the eye wall, where it's moving in, take a look at Lake Charles. It is moving to the north-northwest. You get in a little bit closer, and what we're going to see here is one of two things that's going to be staggering here. If it continues that north-northwest movement, it looks right now that Lake Charles could get in the eye. There's an outside chance that that could happen, but there's also a chance that Lake Charles could stay in that eastern flank eye wall for 4.5 to 5 hours. That's devastating. Now, earlier when you were talking with Derek Van Dam, this is something interesting to point out. This box you see here, an extreme wind warning, it's been issued before, but it's a fairly new product from the National Hurricane Center. It's not used for tornadoes. It's not used for severe thunderstorms, only for approaching eye walls in hurricanes. This area means you will have sustained winds at least 115 miles per hour. So you look at it like a tornado warning. You get into the part of your home, the best shelter, in the basement, what have you. But already we're seeing winds that are well over 100 miles per hour. If you look at the warnings now in red, look how far inland they go, the hurricane warnings. 4.5 million people in the hurricane warnings. In blue are tropical storm warnings. That's another 18 million. Don, you were asking about your family earlier in Baton Rouge. Baton Rouge is 130 miles from the center, and it's just outside of that tropical storm warning. So good news for them. There will be some wind gusts, and they're going to get the rain, but they're not going to see the severity of this. These winds, at least 110. Right now we're seeing gusts inside the center of 185. I mean, this is going to destroy not just homes and businesses, churches, hospitals, schools, but then the winds shift to the other direction. Down trees, power lines, massive power outages, I think, by morning. And then you toss in, of course, the surge, and that's always a big deal. I remember, Chris, when you were with Irma, were you in Naples? Is that where you were when the upwelling of the water came up?
Yeah. And luckily, you told me to get out of there.
Happening here.
When the first time it moved, I was like, well, it's gone now. You said, not for long. Mm-hmm. Time for you to move.
Right.
And we moved, and there were feet of water there with Ed Lavandera and I inside of minutes.
Yeah. This is going to drop at least 8, 10, 12 inches of rain coming down. The big problem really is the surge. I mean, you've got a 20-foot surge right now. Can you imagine that? It's the top of a second-story building. But it's the force that's carrying it inward 30 miles. In 1913, we had, of course, in the Kagoshu River,
carrying it in 30 miles? Mm-hmm. Storm
30
surge?
30 miles. Not all 20 foot, but the surge of the water will go inland.
Wow.
But in 1913, in Lake Charles, the water level got up to 13 feet. It submerged over half of Lake Charles. Mm-hmm. Tomorrow morning, they're looking at a water level at 16.7, or 15.6, that is. That's amazing. And then, so you got the tornado warnings, you got the surge, you got the heavy rainfall, and the wind's doing enough damage. Here's a good indication of your surge. So you see where Cameron is, all the way up to I-10. So there are computer models we're looking at in Lake Charles that are telling us by tomorrow morning, some of the communities and suburbs around Lake Charles will see over 8 and 9 feet of water in their homes. Mm-hmm. I'm telling you, we're looking at a situation where we're going to remember pictures of Mexico Beach when Michael moved through, how homes are off their foundations. We're going to see pictures like Katrina. where people are on their roofs, or even with Harvey, boat after boat of families being rescued tomorrow. I mean, this is going to be devastating, and all we can do is sit back and watch.
Yeah.
There's nothing more that can be done.
Tom, I want you to stand by because we've